Okay, let's find our seats together. It's good to fellowship. We get to fellowship with the Lord through the study of Scripture. Like I mentioned previously, a couple weeks ago and last week, and I'm really, really blessed to have really one of my closest and dearest friends with us tonight to speak. Pastor Mike Neglia is the pastor of Calvary, Cork in Cork, Ireland, and he's been there as the pastor for over 10 plus years, and he's here on somewhat of a little bit of a restful month as well as an updating month, and we as a church have been praying for him and now loving on him and supporting him. So I just am so happy to have him with us tonight. I'm sure I'm going to try to give him as much time as possible instead of lauding his praises. But I'm sure he's fine with it. But just one more thing. He has some prayer cards out here of his beautiful, beautiful family, his wife Rachel, his son Owen, his daughter Rosie, and they have a couple of requests, and then on the back, a way of support. If you'd like to pick one of those up, you are free to do so. There's a whole stack of them out there on the information booth, so feel free to grab one of those. Feel free to talk to him afterwards, hug his neck, but without further ado, I'd like to present Pastor Mike Neglia.
So I believe this is on now. It's a real honor to be here. The last time I was at Calvary Santa Maria was 12 years ago. I spoke at the youth group back there on a Sunday morning, and I must have done such a bad job that I was not invited back for 12 years. So we'll just see how this goes. I count myself to be very, very wealthy because I have more good friends than I deserve, and I know, like, especially male friendship is a valuable and rare thing, and I have more good friends than I deserve, and Connor is just a very, very dear friend of mine and support to me. I've known him since we both were about 18 years old. We attended Bible college together. We were neighbors. God just providentially put us together. Neither of us were probably a good influence on the other one. But over the years, the Lord has brought maturity and sanctification to both of us. And it's great that, you know, we're just two 18-year-olds goofing off in the back when we should have been paying attention, and the Lord has, you know, matured us and given us families and given us ministries. And so I've known him for years and years, and I know the on-stage Connor and the off-the-stage Connor, and let me say, he's the real deal, and he really does care about you guys and this church. All right, so I'm back, and you can stop holding your breaths. So I've returned, and I'm here on March 16th, which maybe some of you know is the day before a special day. What's tomorrow? St. Patrick's Day. Yeah. So for a lot of people, St. Patrick's Day is just this kind of celebration of just a general sense of, you know, Irishness, isn't it? And you know, tonight, like, I just want to point out, like, I am a Californian who lives in Ireland, and we were just led in beautiful worship by a Northern Irish woman who lives in California. So we're just passing the baton back and forth, I suppose. But anyway, And I hear she's very happy here. So for a lot of people, St. Patrick's Day or March 17th is just this general idea of just Irishness, whatever that is, whether it's dyeing the Chicago River green, which they do every year, and I've seen that they've done it this time. Whether it's pinching people who don't wear green clothing, or whether for some or for many, whether it's an excuse for excessive and sinful overconsumption of alcohol, whether it's dyed green or not. But for me and for others and for you tonight, whether you want to or not, it's an opportunity to reflect or to think about the life and mission of our real life brother in Christ named Patrick. He would have been called Patricius by his Latin-speaking parents, who named their little baby Patricius. He would have been called Padraig by his Irish-speaking friends, as he spent the majority of his life living in Ireland. He's a man that God used to totally change the culture of Ireland of his day. Ireland was transformed from a land that was famous for being pagan and barbaric and violent into a land of great Christian faith and teaching. So after Patrick, Ireland was known as the land of saints and scholars. But that certainly was not the case beforehand. So Irish Christians have always remembered and thanked God for the life and the ministry of Patrick. But it wasn't until the 1600s that March 17th was set aside as the official day dedicated to him. And the celebration of St. Patrick's Day was, for a long time, a somber occasion. Interesting fact, it was up until 1961 that every pub in Ireland was closed on St. Patrick's Day as an opportunity to abstain from alcohol and drunkenness and to reflect on the life and ministry of this man. But certainly things have changed, haven't they? So both Catholic and Protestant and even some Eastern Orthodox communities have laid claim to Patrick as one of their own. And which kind of makes a lot of sense, because it's no great surprise, because he's a good guy. It's like when you're picking teams back in PE, if you remember then. It's like the one that you want on your team. Everyone's like, Patrick, he's one of us. And whether or not he would feel comfortable in a church like this, I think is maybe up for debate. But we know that he was a real, true brother in Christ who loved Jesus. He was a great evangelist. He brought the gospel of Jesus to the Irish, and he dedicated his life to the Great Commission. And so kind of my launching text for tonight is going to be the Great Commission, which you can find in Matthew 28. Maybe if you could turn in your Bibles or your apps to Matthew chapter 28. Here we see I want to say the final words of Jesus, but that's not the case, is it? These are the words that Jesus said before he ascended to heaven. But we do know that as the word of God is faithfully preached and listened with faith, that the Lord Jesus is speaking to his church even now. So may we hear the final words Jesus said before he ascended to heaven, but they're certainly not his last words. So it says this: Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountains to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So as we are going to consider a little bit about who Patrick was and what he did, may this just be in our mind that he was someone who was very interested in obeying Jesus Christ and doing what Jesus told him to do. And so tomorrow, as you wear green or don't wear green, I don't care. But tomorrow, as you even think about what it means for it to be St. Patrick's Day, you can think it's not about the green or the rivers or the food or the pinching, but it's just a reminder that God loves Ireland. God loves unreached nations. God loves unreached people groups, and he wants people to hear about Jesus. He wants them to be saved, and he wants healthy churches to be planted all around the world. So this evening, I want to talk a bit about Patrick's life and show how it intersects with the command of Jesus. So when I think about this man's life, and I just got to say, I've lived in Ireland for 12 years. I've been a pastor there for 10 years. I've lived there for 12. And I've just had this long-term hobby, this interest in this man. And so as I think about Patrick and his life, there's really three truths that really resonate with me. And so I think on the slide, it'll show that first thing when I think about what it means to consider the life of this older brother in the faith. When I think about him, I think about what a life lived in obedience to Christ might look like or may look like. So Patrick truly believed that his life was not his own. He really believed that he'd been purchased and bought with the precious blood of Jesus. And so he did what his Lord told him to do. So when I think about him, I think about what a life lived in obedience to Christ might look like. Secondly, it reminds me of God's love for the people of the world in general, and also for the people of Ireland, and God's desire that everyone in Ireland hear the good news about Jesus and be saved. Patrick saw incredible fruit from his labors amongst the Irish people of his generation. We'll talk about that more later on. But just what a reminder that God loves unreached people groups. And maybe in this day and age, there could be different people groups that he is working in and will do amazing things in the future. I hope that 21st century Ireland might be back on the list. But I do know that there's the borders of the kingdom need to expand further out and further in. And then thirdly, and this is most, I guess, exciting to me, God's determination to use surprising choices to act in meaningful ways for the advance of his kingdom. Patrick himself writes frequently about how shocked he was that God would use him. He uses all kinds of self-deprecating language. He describes himself as imperfect, untrained, barely literate, and a sinner. And so he, more than anyone else, is just shocked that God's using him. And that's kind of a theme that we see throughout Scripture. You know, I think about King David, who started out as old what's-his-name. The guy that his father forgot about, the forgotten son of a sheep farmer in a little town of Bethlehem. And he was blessed by God, and he was used in extraordinary ways in his generation. I think about the surprising start of the Apostle Paul, a proud, Christ-hating, religious extremist who was glad to see Christians imprisoned and was glad to see them killed. He was confronted by Christ, and he was converted wholeheartedly to the religion that he was seeking to eradicate. God forgave him of his sins on the spot, and God eventually used him to write most of the New Testament. So when I think about Patrick, it just makes me think and wonder who God is going to use next in a mighty way in our generation. Who will be, if I could say, the next Apostle Paul? Who will be the next Patrick? Or if I could say, who will be the next Paula? Who will be the next Patricia? The next person that God could use to radically impact and shape a nation for Christ might not even be a Christian yet. the next Patrick might be waking up right now at 7:55. Wait. Yeah. He might be waking up with a terrible hangover right now and getting ready for tonight's activities. The next Paul might be praying to Allah right now. But God is determined to use surprising choices to act in meaningful ways for the advance of his kingdom. And so I think of Patrick as an example of that. I'll tell you a bit about Patrick's story. Most of this is from, actually nearly all of this, is from Patrick's own writing. And if you're interested, if you're a research geek like I am, there's no shame, it's cool. I commend to you his writing. It's called The Confessions of Patrick. And you can read it online in a variety of sources. The copyright ran out a long time ago. But I would recommend confessio.ie, confessio.ie. That's a New Living translation of this. It's very readable English. You can find a lot of kind of obscure English translations, but I'd say that's there. It's free. It's short. You could read it in about a half hour. And that could be a good thing for you to do tomorrow. But in Patrick's own story, he says that he was born in Roman Britain near the end of the 4th century. His father was an influential man. His father was a tax collector and also was a deacon of a local church. So he was born into the church. He went to Sunday school. He was educated a little bit. He was also a Roman citizen. He was born somewhere along the western seaboard of Britain. Probably modern-day Wales. Patrick was born during an unfortunate and a dangerous time to be in Britain because as part of the Roman Empire, Rome itself was facing attack from barbarian tribes, and they needed all the soldiers they could get. And so the Roman leaders pulled back military support from the periphery of the Roman Empire to support the heart. And because of that, because the soldiers were at Rome, not in Britain, it means that the western seaboard was open to attack. And it was open to attack especially from Irish pirates who came from Ireland over to Wales to kidnap people and to take them back to Ireland as slaves. Human trafficking, we call it today. So Patrick was, when he was 16 years old, anyone here 16? Anyone here? Used to be 16? All right, I see those hands. When he was 16 years old, he was, kidnapped and trafficked and brought back to Ireland, sold as a slave. And he says that at that point, he was neither a saint nor a scholar. So this quote, in his own words, I did not know the true God. I had turned away from God. I neither kept his commandments nor obeyed my pastors who used to warn me about my salvation. Has anyone here ever been raised in Sunday school and rebelled in your teenage years? So same with Patrick. He just happened to get kidnapped and brought to a foreign country during those times. And for the next 6 years, from 16 to 22, he spent as a captive, as a shepherd, on a hill somewhere in Ireland. We're not sure of exactly where it was. So during those periods of isolation, looking after his master's sheep, Patrick began to seek the Lord. He called out to the God that he used to know but had rebelled against. And he says in his own words, the Lord made me aware of my unbelief, that I might at last advert to my sins and turn wholeheartedly to the Lord my God. So two things happened there. You can see it. He says, firstly, God showed me that I was a sinner. And then secondly, God showed Patrick his son, Jesus, the savior of sinners like him. And Patrick says in his own words that he was born again those days, as many of us have been. And so for Patrick, he says that his lifestyle involved turning wholeheartedly to the Lord. And for him, that meant that his life, which was devoted to himself, was now devoted to the Lord, and also that his life had turned into a life of prayer. He said that in a single day, I would say as many as 100 prayers, and at night, only slightly fewer. He says, I just liked praying. All of a sudden, I had an interest, I had a heart towards prayer. And certainly, isn't that the work of the Holy Spirit in a new believer's life or in any believer's life, that all of a sudden we just want to talk to God 100 times and at night, 99? So this young boy, this young man who had lost everything as he was kidnapped and trafficked, family, friends, country, but yet he found himself in a real relationship with God. You could say that he found God, but in reality, God found him. Because God wasn't lost. Patrick was lost. So God found lost Patrick. So Patrick was a man led by God's Holy Spirit in constant, or as much as he could, frequent communication with God, meditating on the scriptures, and he sought to eventually obey that great commission given to us by Jesus, which we have open in front of us, but just to remind us, go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I've commanded you. So, coming back to scripture, because this is a Bible study, right? Jesus' final words to his disciples before the ascension is what they're supposed to be doing until he comes back again, and that is making disciples. So what is a disciple? The Greek word is mathetes, and it means a learner or a follower. And they're told to be making people followers of Jesus. And I think they understood exactly what it meant to be a disciple of Jesus, because they were the disciples of Jesus. They knew what it meant to be discipled by somebody. They knew for 3 years what it was like to have Jesus Christ involved in every aspect of their life. They learned to trust his wisdom above their own wisdom. They learned to trust his commands. They learned to submit to his lordship over their lives. They learned that his words are always true and never false, and that his care for them is unrivaled and unparalleled. They knew that because they knew Jesus. And Jesus essentially says, right there, before he ascends up into heaven, is, you know what it means to be my disciple. I don't have to explain what it means to be my disciple, because that's what you've been for the past 3 years. Now, go everywhere and get as many people to become my disciples as well. So to put it in a kind of succinct way, in order to show people Jesus, you certainly have to know Jesus first. So he says, you guys know me, now go show me to the nations and show me to the world. But as we know, Jesus didn't just tell that group of men to do that. That's the command that's given to the church. And I want to be the one who, I want to know Christ. I want to make him known as well. And again, I'm no St. Patrick. I hope nobody thinks, this guy thinks he's like the next Patrick. No, I'm not. But I want to, with all that I'm able to, is to know Jesus and then also to show Jesus to those around me. He doesn't say, I want you to go to all the world and to make church attenders. He says, I want you to go into all the world and make disciples. I don't want you to go into all the world and find people and convince them to have a few religious thoughts throughout the week. He says, no, there's more than that. It's to be an actual disciple. A disciple is someone defined as a lifelong learner, transformed into a wholehearted follower of Jesus. And so I hope that I'm speaking to a room full of disciples. I'm glad. Maybe I am, maybe I'm not. Like, coming to church on Wednesday, that's good. Because, you know, most Christians, they only come on Sundays. But you guys come twice a week. That's great. But, I'm only, you guys know that I'm joking, right? It was wrong to think that discipleship is merely church attendance, or even church attendance twice a week. Discipleship is that lifelong learning and wholehearted following of Jesus. And you know, following Jesus means you're going to follow him into church on Sunday morning. You're going to follow him into church on Wednesday night. I'm not anti-church. I'm here, aren't I? So are you. But I do know that there are ways to deepen that. In private, with the spiritual disciplines of personal Bible reading, of private prayer. And there's those public disciplines as well of discipleship, of church attendance, of corporate worship. And Calvary Chapel Santa Maria, wants to help you along the process of discipleship. I know that Tuesday nights, that there are groups called for men to see what it is to be a male follower of Jesus. Not just a male, but a man who follows Jesus. And I do know that on Tuesday nights, and I think Friday mornings too, there's some pretty rockin' women's ministries as well that are, got some amens, that are interested in helping ladies to be disciples and followers of Jesus. And I found this out earlier this afternoon. If you like call the office and say, "Hi, I'm Mike, I want to be discipled," then the church secretary will say, "That's great," and assign somebody to you, someone to walk with you and to be someone who knows Jesus and wants to help you grow into that lifelong learner, turning into a wholehearted follower of Jesus. So again, I'm glad you're here on Wednesday. Please keep coming. But no, the path of discipleship involves so much more. Not less, but more. But Jesus also tells his disciples to go. Like, that's the first word there, to go and to make disciples, baptizing and teaching them. So Jesus' commission definitely includes evangelizing, you know, going to new places and talking to new people and telling them the great news that though their sins are like scarlet, God can make them white as snow. The Apostle Paul definitely understood the need for travel and the need for verbal proclamation. Just listen as I read this famous paragraph from Romans 10, starting in verse 9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That was actually bonus. That was the wrong part. But it's true, isn't it? The next part says, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him in whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how will they preach unless they're sent? As it's written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. So Jesus told the disciples, you're going to have to go. And the Apostle Paul says, absolutely. And he tells the Romans, we're going to have to go. Someone said that the good news is only good news if it gets there in time. And the Apostle Paul says, how beautiful are those feet that are walking and bringing the gospel to the farthest places with that wonderful news. So I love this. This is great. No one says amen in my church. So St. Patrick, so jumping back to St. Patrick, he understood this. So while he was still a slave in Ireland at the age of 22, just, you know, loving Jesus and watching sheep, all of a sudden he has this extraordinary encounter. He has a dream, and in the dream he says that he heard a voice from God that said this, come and see where your ship is waiting. So I think the next night, Patrick slipped away from his master, traveled nearly 200 miles to the Irish coast, and it's a long story, but there's a ship waiting. And he kind of negotiates and gets his way on, and that ship takes him from slavery back home. And he's able to get off, and he gets reunited with his parents. And it's this wonderful reunion, and, you know, it's like the prodigal son comes home, only he didn't want to leave in the first place. And everyone is so happy that he's back. His aging father is talking to him about taking over the inheritance and settling back in his new life. You know, he's glad he's a Christian now, he's glad that he's safe, and everything is going fine until God called Patrick a second time. He had another dream of God calling him to go back to Ireland. So Patrick writes, I seem to hear the voice of the Irish, the voice of the same men who live beside the forest of Falkirk, which lies near the Western Sea and where the sun sets. And then he says, the voice said to him, we beseech thee, holy youth, to come once more and walk among us. So remember earlier I said Patrick would eventually do his part to fulfill the Great Commission. It certainly wasn't his idea. He didn't volunteer. God called him. So just as much as Paul didn't volunteer to become the apostle of Christianity to the Gentiles, Patrick didn't volunteer to go back to the land of his captivity. But afterwards, history tells us that he went to France. He went to kind of a Bible college type thing. He got ordained into ministry. Patrick knew that if he was going to teach the truth, he had to know the truth. So he set time apart to be that student, to study, to know the scriptures, so that once he got there, he'd have something to preach. And, you know, as I mentioned earlier, I went to Bible college. I met Connor there, maybe some of us have, and isn't it a great opportunity to go there? But here's a secret. Bible college is just basically church. It's just basically this, over and over and over again. It's just different people opening up scriptures and talking and explaining. And so if you don't have the opportunity to go spend 2 years in France or Marietta or anywhere else, like just know that being a student of God's word, learning from wise and competent and qualified teachers of scripture can take place here in Santa Maria, can take place in any number of regions. Because Paul tells the Ephesian church that Jesus gave us the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. And so, whatever it takes, get built up, know scripture, so that you have something to pass on, something to share to people. So after he was ordained, he went back. The journey back to Ireland nearly killed him. He says that he was worn out upon his return. Once he got there, he was scared. He says that he was dwelling amongst Gentiles. He was in the midst of pagan barbarians, worshippers of idols, and unclean things. However, his 6 years in captivity had trained him to be understanding of the culture. His years of studying scripture in France have taught him the confidence in God's word, and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit told him that he has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. And so he just gets to work. So rather than resenting the people, the nation that had robbed him of his teenage years, that had taken him from everything that he knew and loved, rather than seething in anger towards them, Patrick, in love, shared the message of the gospel with them. So, again, historians, I'm going to kind of, you know, they talk about the Ireland of his day. It's divided up into regions, and there's local kings, and there's all kinds of crazy violence and drunkenness, and however, like what he did was he just go from region to region. He would seek an audience with the local king. He'd preach the gospel to him. And again, the Holy Spirit was just doing something where people in positions of power and influence had their hearts opened to believe the gospel. And then he was allowed to travel through their regions speaking that same gospel. And over 300 churches were planted by Patrick and by people that he trained during his 29-year ministry that he did in Ireland. 300 churches, they say about 120,000 Irish men and women accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior and were baptized. So, Patrick, the reluctant apostle, Patrick, the unwilling missionary, Patrick, the drafted disciple, I'm making him up as I go, He overcame his fear, and he says in his own words, "Neither must we fear any such risk in faithfully preaching God's name boldly in every place." And so he went, and God gave him extraordinary grace. So that's the kind of biography finished, but just some takeaways. I know that usually this isn't what happens on Wednesday, and I also want to say I don't usually teach this way. But again, it's St. Patrick's Day Eve. Like, what else would I talk about? So I can hope that maybe God would use some of us in extraordinary ways. I would be very surprised if the Lord would use someone in this room, myself included, to plant 300 churches and to see 120,000 people come to Christ. But I do hope, and I do pray, and I have been praying even this afternoon, that we would all see fruitfulness in our lives. God had a unique plan for Patricius, and God has a unique plan for you. And you don't necessarily need a passport or a plane ticket or a boat for you to obey God's will for your life. And as much as I want to talk about, you know, this guy, this older brother in the faith, and how much God used him in that way, and, you know, go find some unreached island and live there for 29 years until you die, and, you know, like, maybe some of you should do that. If you are, you should talk to Dan, the missions pastor. He will hook you up and send you out. But you don't necessarily need to travel across the world to go to the ends of the earth. Like, we live in a very interesting time when people from all over are crossing paths at every point. But also, maybe it's not someone from the ends of the earth. Maybe it's someone just across the table from you. Maybe it's someone across the cubicle or in the cafeteria or across the street or across student housing. The Lord does call us to go, sometimes far and sometimes nearby. I know that there's a great need for the gospel to go deeper and fuller into this generation of Santa Marians. Is that what you call yourselves? I'll call you that. This generation of Santa Marians need the gospel to go deeper and wider. And in the city where I live, the city of Cork, I know that this generation of Corkonians, which is actually what we're called, this generation of Corkonians need the gospel to go deeper and wider across the city. It's a city of 250,000. The recent census says that 1% of the Republic of Ireland would consider themselves to be born again Christians. It's a place full of religious knowledge and then rejection of that. I almost feel like there's an inoculation against the gospel there. You guys know how inoculation works, or vaccines? A tiny little bit of something is introduced to the system so that the body learns how to adapt to it and fight it off. I feel that I live in a country that has been inoculated to the gospel. And so would you pray for us, please? So I'm calling you to go outside of yourself this week. Again, whether it's across the table, across the streets, but to realize that God has gone, in essence, outside of himself for us. I don't want to just say, hey, isn't Patrick a great missionary? End of story. But isn't God a great missionary? The biblical God is by nature a sending God. He's a God who goes outside of himself. Isn't that the great truth of John 3:16, that the Father sends the Son? And isn't that the great truth of John 14, that the Son sends the Spirit? And isn't that the great truth of the book of Acts, where the Spirit sends the church into the world? So I want to encourage you to give it a shot this week, to try to go outside of yourself and to bring this message, maybe tomorrow, as someone is pinching you or something, be like, would you like to hear the real story of Patrick? And there's your in, there's your opening. And as cheesy as that sounds, like, maybe it'll work. And you know what? Maybe you'd be amazed that it works. And as I said at the very beginning, I want to close with this, that Patrick was amazed at his fruitfulness. Of all the reading I've done of his own words, this next paragraph is, like, it gets me, and it's my favorite. So we'll close with this, with Patrick's own words, as he's expressing his amazement that God used him. He says, I am then, first and foremost, unlearned, an unlettered exile who cannot plan for the future. But this much I know for sure. I was like a stone lying deep in the mud. Then he who is mighty came, and in his mercy, he not only pulled me out, but lifted me up and placed me at the very top of the wall. I must therefore speak publicly in order to thank the Lord for such wonderful gifts for the present and gifts for eternity. which the human mind cannot measure. In essence, he's just saying, I'm amazed. I'm amazed that a sinner like me, so deep in the mud, would be rescued, cleaned off, and used. And that's my testimony. And isn't that yours too? And that sort of gospel amazement, it overcomes me at times. I just can't believe I'm a Christian. I just can't believe it. And also, I think the Apostle John is at times overcome with the gospel amazement. And he says this. He says, behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us, that we should be called the sons of God. And that is what we are. He's like, I can't even believe it. Like that we'd be called the sons of God. I'm just amazed by that. So I want to encourage you, go outside of yourselves as the Lord has gone outside of himself for you. And I just want you to join me in just gospel amazement. So I'm going to pray, and I think we have a song or two to just reflect and respond in amazement at God's love and God's work in us. So, Lord, I do not take it for granted. Well, that's not true. Lord, sometimes I do. And forgive me for when I do take it for granted. But, Lord, I pray that those moments would be increasingly rare and far apart. But that, Lord, so often I would be reminded and amazed at your grace and at your love and at your adopting work. Lord, that you would choose to send your spirit to live in me. I thank you for that. Lord, I thank you for older brothers and older sisters that we can read about and learn about throughout church history that have trusted you, Lord, and you've not let them down. They have stepped out in faith and you have used them. My prayer, Lord, is that in this generation, in Santa Maria, Lord, that your church, that these people would trust you and would know, Lord, that you will not let them down. Lord, take steps of faith, Lord, and know that you meet us there. And Lord, that this great gospel that amazed John, that amazed Patrick, that amazed me, Lord, would amaze others. I pray that Sunday and Saturday and these events leading up to Easter, Lord, would be times for the gospel of grace to be seen and shown as amazing as it is. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.